I got a feeling that today's gonna be a good day. That today's gonna be a good day. That today's gonna be a good, good day. A feeling. That today's gonna be a good day. That today's gonna be a good day. That today's gonna be a good, good day. Today's a day. Let's live it up. 24 seasons. Let's give it up. Look how she's smashing. Like, oh my God. Jump off that sofa. Keep watching. Over.
I know the way.
So what could a flash mob have possibly to do with a best-in-class culture change transformation? That's the question we would really like to answer today. And I'm just wondering if some of you already have some thoughts on this. Good morning, everyone. Somebody else?
You have this crazy starters who start to dance and somebody look at them, you know, who are those people? But then they cannot resist and join them because it's so beautiful. It's so energetic. It's so passionate. And we just experienced that 2 weeks ago. So maybe we can share that further later.
That's true. One of my all-time favorite TED Talks is actually one of the shortest TED Talks. I think it's 3 minutes long. And it shows how movements really happen on the example of, I guess, an open air festival. And so it's all about followership. And I think this video, one, it was a nice way of just allowing people who just start late. So apologies for calling you out, Maria. And then two, also, I really feel that this is the kind of movement, the kind of energy you can create. And it's sometimes very unexpected. Of course, a flash mob is something that was prepared. At the same time, just to see how it builds up, how more and more people join in, this is exactly the momentum that really gives me and gives us And so with that, John, I actually hand it over to you to do the official introduction. The
official introduction. Very nice. Well, no, I'm happy to take a backseat to you guys. That's really what this session today is all about. So obviously the topic for the session is best practices in terms of culture and culture development. And very happy to be joined by the two of you, Sabina and Anna from Bayer. Sabina, sorry, from Magnolia Tree, and of course, Anna from Bayer. I have to say, this is, first of all, this is the topic that we're always excited about, and a lot of times the clients that I'm newly in contact with or have just gone through the kind of assessment that we provide with OCI are very interested in, right? What are the best practices? How should we roll this out? What are the pitfalls? Those sorts of lessons learned. But beyond that, you know, this is really an example I've been looking forward to, because this is, for all of you, this is really a shining example of how culture can be connected to values, introduced to the organization, introduced to leaders, and really has taken off and created the kind of effect and impact, I think, that we saw in that video. So very, very fitting. Thank you guys so much for being willing to share these insights. I think they're invaluable, and really look forward to your input. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And my colleague Elke Pichler, she's going to navigate us through some activities and a mural board that we've created for you. We want this to be a very interactive session for most of the time. In the beginning, it will be Anya and I just sharing our perspective. What were the ingredients? Which of those items could we recommend to either change practitioners or change consultants? And we really want to make space for any questions and any comments. We have some friends and family here too. So Anna, who just spoke, she's actually a sponsor of this culture change journey. So she was really there from its initiation. So it will be fantastic to have her perspective. We have some community members of you know, of the Bayer People and Culture Change team. And so, you know, I think you're in for hopefully quite a lighthearted and fun and still informative session. So Anya, actually with that, I just hand it over, and I know it sounds cheesy and corny. Having said that, I really do not say this lightly. This is by far my most fun and exciting culture change or people and culture change advisory journey and project. And I feel very privileged to be a part of this. And most of you don't know me in person, so you don't know that I don't really say this lightly. I really mean it sincerely. So I'm very excited to share this. And I wouldn't have done it without you, Anya. So this is over to you. Where were you about 2.5, 3 years ago? Could you just share part of your journey at that time?
Sure, and thank you, Sabina. So as you see, Sabina called me Anya, but it says Anna on my name screen, but this is how everyone calls me. So if it's Anya and Maria, I assume you're also from Poland, so you will know this as well. So what I would like to do is to give you a little bit of context before we go into the best practice, that you understand what we are we even talking about, what is the organization we are talking about, what did we actually do. So I take you a little bit back in time. As Sabina mentioned, it's 2.5 years ago. Bayer as a company has been going through some big transformation initiatives. We all hear about it in the news currently as well. It's about how do you reorganize yourself to be ready for the future. For us, we are part of our procurement organization within Bayer. We are talking about a global procurement organization. What does procurement do in a corporate like Bayer? We basically buy things, right? So we are responsible for supporting our organization in contact with our external suppliers. We have been going through a major transformation ourselves. Probably some of you are kind of aware, you sometimes move from local organization to more global focused organization. We were going through the operational changes, through the operating model change. And we realized that with the number of changes that were happening to our organization, we need to do something different. We need to make sure that we don't only focus on the processes, the systems, but we also need to focus on how we work, right? How do we deliver the value that we want to kind of give to both our internal colleagues in procurement, but also to our suppliers and stakeholders. And what happened at that point in time was, okay, the question was asked about our leadership team. What is the strategy for the future? What does procurement has to deliver for the future? How do we build kind of better organization for our people? And as many of you know, when you start with a strategy, there is always a funny work stream that would be called people, culture, upskilling, change, communication, whatever you want to call it. There is always a work stream that is connected, something to do with people. And very often it's not super well defined in the very beginning. You are supposed to do something that people are more excited about the strategy. In our case, we were super lucky because as Sabina mentioned, we had Anna and also one other person of our leadership team, Patrick, sponsors who from the very beginning said, if we are doing this, we are doing it right. And what did that mean for us is we really wanted to make sure we are talking about tangible behavioral change. So we don't do things just to make our life easier, more fun. It's also important, but what we really kind of focus on is how do we make sure that what we create is long-term tangible change. And with this, Anna and Patrick started to look for two, and I mean, they found two people, and we were a group of four that came together and started to think, what does that mean for us? And this is when we actually came across human synergistics, the first time met John and fall in love with the methodology, I have to say, because the methodology of human synergistics was answering to our needs of, we wanted something that is science-based, that will give us the data and not kind of make us decide on what we do just on our gut feeling, but something that really we will learn from our organization, but something that we really can prove with a different organization, how does it work, that it's not only self-made in our their world. That was the one thing. And the second thing was, we also started to learn a lot ourselves, right? So we started to learn about what culture is and what it isn't. It's not only a buzzword that everyone is using. We started to figure out how we can learn ourselves, but how we can also teach this to our organization. And then we made a decision, we actually want to use the tools. We have gone through a diagnostic process of using both organizational culture inventory and effectiveness ones. So we measured both climate and culture elements. And I always say in this moment, I would always recommend to use both. I believe only using the culture one only gives you the indication where you are, but not necessarily what you need to change. And we'll in a moment be explaining what are the climate elements that we have learned. But long story short, we got the data. We're super overwhelmed because you get 600 pages report, and we thought, okay, we are all up for it, but we need help. And that was the moment in time when we started to also work with John and the team, but also realized we would need a change consultant that would help us to plan the journey ahead. This is how we met Sabina, because Sabina, and actually it's also a personal story, Sabina met Anna on one of the human synergistics trainings. And this is how we came together to work on the next steps. And I have to say, and Sabina will talk about some of the elements that we believe are crucial to our journey. I also want to mention that for us, Sabina, and here I also recommend, because I wasn't convinced in the beginning, to have an external person helping us. But what is the beauty in this is also that someone puts a mirror in your face, because we are part of the system, right? We are part of the culture that we have realized we have in Bayer. It's very difficult to change it from the inside, even if you know all the elements that you should be doing. It's so helpful to have someone from time to time to tell you and poke you a bit, guys, you are acting in the same way that you would kind of challenge your people not to do. So this was super helpful. And I think Sabina will talk about what were the different elements that we have created. But again, long story short, we started with a group of crazy people that wanted to make a difference. We used the data, we analyzed what we have, and based on this, since now 2 years, we are executing on the roadmap, making sure that this is something that is sustainable and not something that would change overnight.
Thank you so much, Anya. Thanks for sharing that. And so what was my change consultant's perspective? Actually, I don't like the word consultant, so I prefer something like pathfinder or transformation architect. I'm personally very, very critical with our industry. And so this was maybe another factor where we connected. And I will ask my colleague Elke to actually share the mural board we have prepared for you, What we want to show you is we actually want to show the story of Sonia Knips. I will use that story to tell you a bit about my perspective coming into this work and what do I try to do, because there are some parallels in the saying she could have been beautiful if someone had told her. But let's take a look at Sonia Knips' story. So Sonia Knips came out of an impoverished royal-like family. She had to marry very young. She had to marry very wealthy, and she did that. So she married into a very wealthy industrial family. This picture was taken when she was 20 years old. Would you have guessed that? It would just be great to see your reaction. Thumbs up, thumbs down for a second. Who would have guessed that she was 20 years old? No. Yeah, no. Me neither. In fact, apparently she was severely depressed. She took a lot of medication at that time. And as we know now, those medications were, of course, very strong ones. However, because her family had a lot of money, they decided to engage an upcoming artist to paint a portrait. The artist was Gustav Klimt. And Gustav Klimt had a very deep creative process, apparently. Apparently, he tried to get to know his models quite well. He probably also had a side of flattery. I don't want to disregard this. In this process with Sonia, though, what they did is they apparently spent quite a bit of time together. And it was the first portrait that he drew based on a photograph. So he had this photograph and some other photographs as a basis for his portrait. And so what Eric is going to show you now is actually what did he make of Sonia Knips? And what he did, we think, is quite astounding. And for those of you who visit Vienna, where Magnolia Tree is headquartered, you can actually go into the Belvedere and you will see the painting of Sonia Knips. So above, you see the painting. Now, clearly, when I first saw this, I thought this has nothing to do with the photograph. So there is an element of flattery. Having said that, what Gustav Klimt also said is that he tried to paint her in the way that he experienced her in a being, or that he experienced her charisma or her aura. So if we just zoom in a little bit more, Erika, into it, you will see it's actually a really an almost translucent image, right, of a very slim down figure, still a serious face expression, but quite soft in the dress and so on. And there are photographs of this portrait being hung in the dining room or in the salon of the family. So it must have been a place where maybe Sonia Knips would walk by a couple of times a day. For sure, this image must have had an impact. The reason why we know this is because the picture below, the photograph below, shows Sonia Knips in her 30s. And so what happened?
She started to believe in herself.
Yes, I think so too. I think this is a fair assumption, right? For me, certainly she looks a lot more like the portrait, right? She became that person. So the saying, my colleague Daniela has been really trying to find out where this, who said this quote, because I heard it when I was about 15 years old and it touched me deeply. We don't know who actually said it, but this quote of she could have been beautiful if someone had told her is the essence of my work. So before I take on any engagement, I'm actually really selective with the clients that I take on. I try, and I think this is maybe a bit more common in the industry, but I really try to, one, take on only clients where I believe I have a very high probability of making a difference. So 90% of hire. Or higher. And the second piece is I only take on such engagements where I believe that there is something beautiful inside the shell. So if I take all the clutter and the noise away, there is actually something beautiful in it. And usually the compass for that for me is, do my values align? And that was certainly the case with this change team that you meet today. And so before we go into telling you what we did and what we think is the right approach, which, by the way, is an invitation, it's not a dogma. So we want you to be free to take away whatever suits you and also leave behind whatever does not. We actually want to do a two small things. One, I would like to ask you a couple of questions about culture change. These are not mine. These are actually from my professor. I studied organization psychology and change leadership already in an executive master's program. So I had already implemented some change efforts in my last industry. And Elke, you can actually keep on sharing the board. That's fine. You can just go to the picture of the homeostasis. Yeah, perfect. So I started studying this after having already successfully implementing some, or having been on a journey of implementing some culture change journey within the company that I was previously working in. I worked in finance for 20 years. I'm not a consultant by trade. I'm a consultant by choice. It feels like my life's purpose to do this work. But before then, I worked in the finance industry in various different leadership roles. And my last role, I was the global head of organization effectiveness for the rating agency Standard & Poor's. So I had sort of practical experience, but I really wanted the theory. And so I studied at Columbia University, change leadership. And one of my professors, he gave us a managing change questionnaire. And I'm just going to ask you just a handful of questions. And it would be great if you use the chat function to just say, is the statement true or false? So it's a binary answer. It's either true or it's false. You can either just type a T or an F, or true or false, or, you know, in German, richtig oder falsch. So we just start with it. We wait for your response. Then we have a quick discussion about it, and then we move on. Does that work for everybody? Cool. Fantastic. So first question. And I should say, we had the biggest row of the whole program over this questionnaire. Okay, so chances are we might not all agree with the outcomes. But I tell you what the professor said is right. Okay, so first question. People invariably resist change. True or false? Okay. Whoever responded with my Zoom, this is great. So when you see, so it's probably someone on my team that actually uses my Zoom credentials. But actually, Alexandra, you are right. Alexandra, why is this statement false?
Hey, so sorry, I had to unmute myself. So because it's not a given. There might be instances where people want to, or they simply resist change, but you cannot kind of go into a situation and assume that. On the contrary, right? It's up to us to frame the situation and to look what's in the change. So this is why I said false.
Thank you, Alexandra. This is spot on. So the correct answer is it's false, because oftentimes when we speak of organizational change, we forget that us as human beings, we embrace change. I mean, we change the cells in our body apparently every 7 years or so, right? We are almost a new being. We love to fall in love. We might not like breakups, but we certainly embrace falling in love, especially if it's reciprocated. Some of us made a choice to get married. Most of us did that voluntarily. We decide to become parents. We decide to move houses. We decide to change countries or jobs. And oftentimes those changes are not tough. So what can we actually do to instill some of that wisdom and knowledge into an organization? So first question. Second question. In any change effort, again, true or false answer, in any change effort, communicating what will remain the same is as important as communicating what will be different. True or false? I say it again. In any change effort, communicating what will remain the same is as important as communicating what will be different. Yeah, you all got it right. Exactly. So no explanations needed. You all said it's true. course, we have to communicate what will remain the same. It eases the system. And then I just give you a third question. As movement toward a new future begins, members of an organization need both time and opportunity to disengage from and grieve for the loss of the present state. True or false? As movement toward a new future begins, members of an organization need both time and opportunity to disengage from and grieve for the loss of the present state. And this is true. So we need to remind ourselves that people do not invariably resist change. There's change that they can embrace, one. And two, we all intuitively know that, of course, we need time to grieve and we need to allow time to grieve. And of course, we need to explain to people what remains the same as much as sharing what will be different. But those two items are ingredients that, in my opinion, are lacking in most change efforts. And so when you don't allow and appreciate and create the space to grieve and to understand what will not change, you already set yourself up for failure. And so with that, I will actually go into a bit of a sparring and dialogue with Anya about what we actually thought our steps were. And these are, by the way, not linear. Some of those steps happened at the same time. Some of those steps are still ongoing. This is really, really a list of ingredients. And in order for it to become a tasteful recipe, you will have to make sure that it fits in your context and in your needs. So with that, we will actually go to our action plan. And thank you, Elke, for driving us through this. What I want to say is that what you're looking at right now is a high-level ingredients list of a journey that is about 2.5 to 3 years old. So it's 2.5 to 3 years in a 6 to 9 years journey, most likely. So what you see is the beginning has been very strong. At the same time, we don't know yet if it will eventually be successful. We hope it will. We have strong signs that it has a good momentum, but also just understand the perspective and the timeline and what we share today. So this has been a very strong start. This year will be tough. I think it will be put to the test. The team is prepared for that. But also keep in mind that, of course, this is maybe halfway through or a third through of a longer term journey. I said it earlier, please feel free to disagree. Please only take what is relevant. This is just a suggestion. And this is really just meant to share with you what is it that we do. And so for starters, one, and I had very little to do with that, we created a winning team. You created a winning team. So Anna and Anya were there from the beginning. I would ask you to actually share your perspective. The only thing that I felt I really was able to contribute and the only wisdom that I would like to share on creating a winning team is that it's very frustrating for me as an external force to see that oftentimes people in coach project teams or people in culture transformation teams are actually equipped with people who have project management skills. And now you might wholeheartedly disagree with me on that, and that's completely cool, but I think it's the wrong skill set. I don't think, especially at the beginning of a journey, you need people who understand projects and Kanban and whatever, scrums and whatever name you want to give it. I believe what you really need is you need two people. You need a person that is strategically savvy and has a matrix or X-ray-like view of the organization, so who has a strong intuition for where the organization really is at and what it can cope with. And you need a second person that is a really good community builder. You probably need, in this case, there definitely was a tech team. I think it would be difficult to put this on one person's shoulder, but a community builder is somebody who is really good in creating a following, who's really good in inspiring and exciting people to participate. And he's not here today, but this this people and culture team certainly has one of those. And I remember some of the very first conversations. It was before the roles were permanently created. It was when Anya and her colleague Ali still had day jobs. And I remember I really counseled the sponsors at that time to say, listen, you know, let's not make this an Excel spreadsheet and a PMO, so project management type role. Let's really focus on the community and let's really focus on exciting people in the system and set yourself up that way. So you do not need a project plan and a spreadsheet. And in fact, you see the roadmap behind Andre and Anya, and this is our way of spreadsheeting the journey. So with that, I just hand it over to Anya and maybe also Anna to just share your perspective on that. What did you do to create a winning team? And
maybe I can say a few words and then Anya, yeah, please go ahead. Sabine, you're absolutely right. So when let me start with the beginning, right? So procurement leadership team decided that we need this piece, as Anya said, piece about people and culture into integrated into our strategy. And then we were supposed to find leaders for the project. And then the idea was to find the one person, and we had two passionate people who raised their hand and say, hey, we are passionate about people and culture. We have no idea what we're gonna do. So, and then we thought together with Patrick, who was another sponsor from PLT, why we should choose one person. Let's take all people who are really passionate about the topic and let's work together on that. And then we came together. So two sponsors and two crazy people, Anya and Ali together. And guess what? We were supposed to fill in exactly the table with milestones, with resources needed and all this wonderful PMO related stuff. And we look at it and realized we cannot do it. It's simply so unnatural to look at this topic like culture change from the perspective of filling in the tables. And then we just took the free writing approach and we wrote a white paper or what does it mean for us? What kind of culture we want to have? What is the organization environment we want to leave? We want to come every day. And that's how it all started. We started with the dream. And then having Anya and Ali so passionate and engaged, they found human synergistics, and Anya will tell you more. So I think the main thing is to follow your dream, to have those crazy, in a good way, in the best way I can describe, people next to you, and then you will definitely make it happen. So Anya, now I want to give the floor to you to tell more in more details.
I just want to comment, and Sabine is usually our timekeeper. We have 18 minutes.
Ah, that's true.
We are completely behind the schedule, so probably we need to speed up on some.
No, actually, don't worry. We're completely on time. Completely fine.
But what kind of for me was, we also talked about it with John already. From the very beginning, we said, follow what you preach. And as soon as we learned constructive culture, we do this ourselves first. And I think this was also key in terms of for us to challenge ourselves, how we work together, that we show up how we would like other people to show up. It's not always easy. You also trick yourself up. It's not that we kind of have it all figured out and always behave how we would like the culture to look like, but I think this was key, that we came together and we really put kind of the target first on ourselves before we put it on other people.
Yeah, thank you for that. Now, when you have a winning team, what do you have to do next? You have to make sure that they can really influence and shape the system. So you have to put them at the top of the house. Now, intuitively, I see that often happens, but it happens more in an advisory function. That's not what I mean. I don't mean make them report out or, sit in on sessions that are culture transformation related. What I really mean is make them appear to the most senior leadership team there is. Now, here we don't talk about buyer as a whole. We talk about the procurement organization, which used to be 1,500 employees, now is roughly about 650 employees. There is a leadership team, and you heard Anna refer to it as PLT, it's the procurement leadership team. That's the top function in this system. So it made absolute sense to make sure that Anya is an essential member of the team, and she takes part in every gathering, in every meeting, and she is an equal eye-to-eye peer. So that was really critical for me to make sure that that actually happens. And, you know, it was great that we had the openness as well, but it also took some lobbying and some understanding that this is really essential. And I think that that is what often makes or breaks those change efforts. Is there anything, Anya, you would like to add from that? Perfect. And I think this links into the third ingredient, which is really, we called it craft the top leadership agenda. But what we mean here is, do make sure that leaders are exposed to the journey. Having said that, don't report to them. So I already said that, right? Don't try not to report out to them. Try to create moments of co-creation, and especially, and I think this is really important for me, that's why you see a heart jumping up and down, it's so much more important to help them experience what new or what this evolution could look and especially feel like. Because once they experience it, they actually build a reference for what it could be, and then they know when they experience it again, or they might get some ideas in how to instill it. We used the leadership impact from Human Synergistics for that. Having said that, we did not prescribe it. So we gave it as a voluntary tool. All leaders agreed to do it. And we made the coaching sessions voluntary as well. So this was something that we set up in a way with a couple of ground rules, like what is the minimum that we expect? The minimum is that you thank the people who give you feedback, but we do not expect you to go beyond. You can, however. So we tried to leave a lot of room for individual leaders to decide how they want to take it on and create a natural pull with this. We had quarterly offsites, you see that. And I think with that, Anya, you wanted to add something to this.
Yeah, because I want to talk about the eye-to-eye and the co-creation, because I think this was also a personal growth for me in terms of switching from, I will now come here to entertain you and to present something to you, to we are all in this together. And I believe this is something that for everyone who drives a program like this, it needs to start with your change in terms of, am I doing it for myself? Am I doing this for the organization? And if I'm doing this for the people, how do I make sure that I bring people on board and not only let them kind of make a decision or a choice, but really involve them? Because, and now using a little bit the human synergistics language, what very easily can happen, you invite people to either avoid the topic or oppose the topic completely if you only propose it to them, right? If you only come to them as the showman, and I will give you all my beautiful slides and I will explain the world to you, right? What happens very often is either people switch off, I don't care about this because I've heard this so many times before, or I will tell you why it will not work, because again, we've done this so many times before. So the solution for this to shift from, I will now propose and offer something, to what can we do together and how can we shift this? And already living the behaviors we want to see, right? So I think this is something, but again, it was also a journey. It didn't start like this. It took us some time to actually get there, because again, I was raised in Bayer, meaning I was raised in a different culture, right? I was raised in a culture that you are proposing something, you are the one who actually is asking for a decision and not necessarily inviting people for co-creation. So you need to challenge yourself. Am I acting in the culture I want to be in, or am I acting in the current culture, and then adjust accordingly?
Thank you. We did have a lot of time. So as well, for those of you who are on people and culture journeys right now, who are consulting, we really had, this leadership team already has a habit of meeting quarterly at an offsite for, I think, 3 to 4 days on average. We typically had 1 to 2 days with them just on people and culture. So do make sure, especially in the beginning, that you really have sufficient time, and this time should be experience-based if you want some tips on what to do, you can always reach out to me or to Anya, I'm sure, as well. Afterwards, we can share in a bit more detail. It took probably 12 months or so to really have the leaders fully on board. Having said that, we really managed to change their group dynamic and their thinking. It's quite rewarding to actually see that. So that was fantastic. And I think this leads me to point four, which is really important. Try to create a pull effect. So don't push things down the throat of the organization. Be okay with it not being attractive for many people, especially in the beginning. And I think with this, I want to share something, a perspective just as a consultant. It's also really important that when you are consulting clients, that you don't become the face of the transformation. So I think it took maybe, it was really until your conference, probably 2 years or so, before I became visible to the organization at all. I never went to any town hall meetings. I never spoke, because that's not my role. My role is to strengthen the transformation team and maybe to hold up the mirror to the leadership team, which arguably is tough when you're dependent on the privileged people in the system, right? To do from within, but that's my role, that's it. So I think it's also really important to always be in check with the consultants that you work with and what is the right level of exposure in the system. So the more you actually create a sort of natural interest, and the more you will create experiences, the more likely you will create that pull, the better it is. And yes, it takes time, but you will see it's actually a much more sustainable approach. And so our guiding principle here was really, people may not remember what you did. They will definitely not remember what you said, but they will always know how you made them feel. So whenever the people and culture team had an engagement, talked at a town hall, it was a lot more about creating moments of experience than actually lecturing.
And looking back rather than forward, I think that that's also one topic. Not overpromise and underdeliver. Rather talk about the things that you've actually done, because this makes a huge difference. Instead of trying to sell something and then have people disappointed, but actually do it and then talk about it. It just creates a different way of inviting people and being curious to experience this themselves.
Yeah. And so we go into step number five. So step number five is really about managing expectations. And I think this might have been the hardest crunch point. And at the same time, in a weird way, it puts so much ease into the system. So be realistic about how long this culture's journey is going to take. Typically, even without knowing the evolution stage the culture is in, I always start with saying it will take 6 to 9 years. And John is really the expert, but I really recommend you all to read the white paper on the evolutionary stages of organizations. So if you are just at the beginning, it will definitely take you 9 years. And if you're a bit further along, it might be 6, and maybe you can accelerate it by a year or so. But I don't think it's feasible to assume any culture transformation in shorter than 6 years. So bringing that bad news quickly is actually cool, because it takes out pressure. It takes out performance anxiety and pressure in the system. And I think this is the most critical piece to do. So to avoid tripping all over one another and trying to push things that are not ripe yet, because the phasing and the timing, the leading and pacing is going to be really critical. And so let's come to step six. While you need to know about 6 to 9 years, you definitely also need to know about two items that I feel are in a way underrepresented in culture change. One is definitely group dynamics. This is why in the regional meeting of human synergistics in Vienna in April, we actually invest, I think, a whole hour, John, right, on group dynamics. So I'm gonna lead a session just on group dynamics and how and which items of that is important in culture change and change efforts. And the second piece is just to always be mindful of a system's need to go back to its base state. So homeostasis means nothing else than we want to go back to base camp, and that's completely normal. It's completely natural. So to help people understand that, and then to help them understand some of the drivers like group dynamics or substantial changes that you can make to make sure that the system does not bounce back after a year, 2 years, or 3 years. That, I think, is an important ingredient for success as well. And the more leaders understand this, and the more leaders are aware about their own group dynamics, like the procurement leadership team, the more they can call it out with one another, so it's help for self-help, but the more they can also instill it within their own leadership team, which again makes it easier on the change team because they don't have to do the heavy lift of it. Anya, anything to add on that?
I think this was one of the most eye-opening conversations we had with Sabina in terms of realizing even if you do everything well, there is a moment when the system or the organization, without any bad intent, will try to pull you back. And you see this, right? And for many different reasons, it can be kind of something that you don't even necessarily recognize. So I think that this was for us a huge learning and something that also, as you say, Sabina, it takes the pressure off that this will happen. You just need to be prepared and figure out how do you really make a change to the organization that can be sustainable and is not just rejected over time.
If I can add one comment here, we also need to keep in mind that we are not only talking about procurement organization within Bayer, which tends to homeostasis, right? But it's the whole environment outside of procurement because we are part of a huge organization. And we decided to go through this journey no matter what, right? So it's not only internal homeostasis, it's also external, which definitely influencing us so much. And to be mindful about that and trying to marry our internal culture journey together with Bayer global tools, approaches, and so on is also a big piece of work that we are doing every day.
Yeah, thank you. And I think the next couple of points, they will be quite quick, but they're important nonetheless. So I will just run through them. One is the tipping point as well. Some of you might know this theory. I find it to be true. So go for the 33%. Don't go for 50 or for 100%. You only need a bit more than a third or roughly a third of the organization to want to be a part of this. And that will make a movement that is going to be extremely hard, extremely difficult to stop. So this, I think this is also just important to keep in mind, because I see that there is an aspiration to go for 100% all of the time. And you just set yourself up for misery, I think, if you go for that. So take comfort in the 33%. And the next piece, Elke, if you open that up, it's also connected. With those 33%, actually build communities. And you have some community members here in the procurement organization. They have two. They have a core group that's called Changemakers. They're volunteers who are especially onboarded into this journey, who in their free time and in their additional time take on workshops, take on education in the system, and work on streams and sub-projects. And then you have a group of that is a lot larger. I think you have about 90 or so people joining, and that is a group of multipliers. Those are just people that are invited to a standing meeting to participate in topics around people and culture. And those topics and those experiences are done in a way that are plug and play, so they can put it back into their organization and share it with their team if they want to. But if they don't, it's also fine. Having said that, everything is built around sharing and experiencing. And then the last couple of points are really just about how to help an organization get the information it truly needs and not too much. Depending on whatever your culture assessment is, you should be selective with the information. This will be counterintuitive, and I don't even know, John, you might actually completely disagree, but we made a very conscious choice to only share the composite of the circumplex and some of the hygiene and climate factors. We decided not to go for the full detail, especially not to go for any comparative data. So we decided not to actually reinforce the competition in the system. We actually just try to stay high level. The team might choose to do it differently when they take the assessment, culture assessment again next year. But at that moment in time, the culture was not ready for the data. So we just did not share it. And there are a couple of items that we are in the process of working on. I would just highlight them, but just like Anya said, we should only talk about things when they're really ripe to talk about. We just did a pilot in Latin America for what is called immersions. It's now a bottom up, if you want, now for the first time, a pull approach or a push approach, actually, where the team offers experiences for a couple of days to everyone on site in a location. And the reason for that is that right now the privilege is with those whose leaders are completely bought into this culture journey. So those people have a lot more access to some of these experiences, whereas if your top leader is not as engaged, chances are you never heard of it. So to set to create an equal playing field, this is why we just piloted some immersions, and the team is working on a rollout strategy for that. And then, we have the next step as well, which is we're going to be working this year a lot more with the frozen middle, so the mid-level leaders, and make sure that we touch them. So there will be an element of leadership development coming their way. And then at last but not least, we have throughout all of this used a very simple model to help people anchor themselves into the journey and their teams in their journey. And that's the transitions model by William Bridges, which really has three different elements to it. And it's a very simple, very intuitive model that I recommend using if the density of the information through human synergistics is too much for leaders and members of an organization that are not in touch with it as much as we are. And I think with that, I wrap my part for sure. You heard Anya's voice in this. And John, I hand it over. We just have a couple of minutes for maybe one or two questions or any comments actually from you as well. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a few notes, but absolutely phenomenal. First of all, thank you so much for sharing the insights and the journey thus far. It's again, one of the most successful. I think you've shared that insight that we see. So it's just really exciting and rewarding to see this kind of initiative taking place. You know, I always say the tools that we provide and the data and reports and so on that we provide is wonderful information, but it doesn't create change. It creates clarity and understanding and an understanding of where we are and where we need to go. But it's your efforts and the efforts is described in the organization, taking those steps that create the change. So love it. Very, very, very exciting. I agree with your points. I'm just very, very briefly, I always recommend to clients not to dig into too much detail in the very beginning. You know, our tools are designed to give you a very thorough understanding of what's taking place, but especially in the initial steps of culture development, and also especially in certain situations like mergers and acquisitions, it's important to focus on the overall information. And that makes sense, I think, in terms of what we talk about with culture, because we're trying to build a shared community and a shared understanding of, you know, what we are and what we're about and where we're going and what we all need to be a part of. And that's more about the commonalities amongst us in the organization than it is about the differences throughout. So I think that's absolutely the right way to focus. Last point I'll make, and then in the interest of time, your 30% rule I like very much. I see a lot of organizations hesitating and waiting to kick off initiatives until everybody's on board and everybody's bought in. But, you know, to be honest with you, it's not necessarily a realistic expectation. And the other point I like to make is, thankfully, we do good work. I mean, meaning what we do is positive and healthy and contributes to the well-being and performance of the people in the organization. So in your work is much more a part of that perhaps than ours in human synergistics. But the point is that what we do is to the benefit of your people. And if we can get that 30% to buy in and take the initial steps, you know, a lot of other members are hesitant and they're not sure about this. And we've had change before and it wasn't a positive thing. But as they see this kind of development implemented and starting to kick off and take effect, they recognize it's a positive thing. And as you said, it creates a pull within the organization where people say, we really want to be a part of this. We want to support this. We've seen what's going on and it's exciting and positive, and they want to contribute. And that's exactly the kind of effort that constructive culture is all about. So very much agree with that point.
Thank you. I actually have some time, so I can stay a bit longer. I don't want to speak for anyone else, but if there are some questions and you know it takes us past the time boundary, I'm happy to stay on.
May I ask a question?
Of course.
Okay. Because you are part of the big organization Bayer, yes, and you are only part of that. So how you can change the culture only in this part without changing the whole organization? Because there are some, you are part of some systems, yes, some procedures, etc. If you could say more about it.
I can start, but I would actually say, because we asked the same question to John when we started. Can we even do it, right? So I think that this is also a good answer in terms of beyond Bayer, but I can give you an answer to Bayer. Is, first of all, for us, it was crucial when we even started, when we created an ideal culture, right? When you kind of, if you go through the process and you decide what is your ideal, the first step that we've done, we matched them with the help of John to our Bayer values. So it already gave us kind of the proof of we are doing something that is in line with what the entire company is doing, right? So our company, we call them life values. They are perfectly matching, of course, the constructive behaviors. It's most often by definition, I guess, John, right, that most company values will be matching the constructive culture. But this was something important to explain to people. We are not doing something different. We are following what Bayer is doing in terms of our life values. The difference that we make, though, is that we actually measure, are we living those life values currently, yes or no? And our answer was unfortunately not, because we are not kind of mostly constructive yet, right? So this was the first point to understanding the direction that we are taking is the same that the entire company is supposed to take. However, we measure it differently. I also want to say that at the same time, you're completely right. We have some systems, tools that we don't have the power to change fully. We are happy to have Anna, who is also representing our HR community. We try to influence whatever we can influence. And this is kind of also the recommendation we took from John and a bit of a 33% logic. If you are successful with procurement, this will spread in the organization. So we always get kind of said to ourselves, if you start with yourself, I start first with me on an individual basis. Then I start with the team that is the closest to me. And then I start with the organization that I have the power to influence and change, and hope that because we are procurement, we have contacts across the entire organization, also with our suppliers, that this will create the ripple effect. So ideally, probably John would tell you, you should have the CEO as the sponsor of this and do this top down. That was not the case for us. I still believe we can make a difference.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I agree completely. Just to jump in, I mean, there's sort of the theory around culture change, and then there's the actual practice. I mean, theoretically, if you want to shift culture, you really need to start at the top, focus on the entire organization, you know, roll this out. That's in theory, the most effective and fastest way to make this change. Having said that, I can't recall the last client that we've had that's come to us and said, we're going to, you know, leadership's all bought in. We're going to do this across the whole organization, top down. You know, this is, we're ready. It doesn't happen that way. Clients come in a very pragmatic way in terms of this part of the business has an issue, or this part of the business really recognizes we want to need to do something differently. We start there. Many times that's a leadership team or a functional area. But in any case, we create that pull by, I always tell people, focus on the part of the business that you can change and affect. Mm-hmm. Don't go broader than that. If you know, whatever the area is that you can influence, that's what we need to focus on. And thankfully, we have the scalability to do that. And then what we find is, you know, again, we do good things and create positive change and development, and other areas of business begin to recognize that and buy in. And then we can create a situation where the entire organization eventually does get behind this, and we do and are able to shift the culture of the organization. But that's a learning journey. And oftentimes that starts in other places than, you know, at the very, very top.
And, you know, just an additional piece to the puzzle here, what I also find in change is that very often we start with the most privileged part of the system, when really, what is my benefit of changing if I already hold the power in the system, if I already get the best resources, if I already know that I'm the epicenter of decision making? In fact, any single system, I actually wrote a paper that has still not been published on this, but every single system where I asked who holds the power in your system had an answer. So we do know that, right, in organizations. And what I found is it's a lot smarter to start change in an organization, a function that is more has the characteristics of an underdog. And what I mean by that is you don't want to go to a scapegoated organization. So you don't want to go to the organization that acquired that is blamed for everything that goes wrong, but go to an organization that is connected with every other part of the business. And at the same time has the feeling that it has not been seen, not been heard, not been validated. Because the people in that part of the system, they are a lot more hungry for this change, especially culture change. And they will see what's in it for them. And when they start to drive it and they, like a procurement organization, are in touch with every other part of the system, there will come a moment when it's just a ripple effect. And it will be so much easier to actually instill the change that you want in the organization.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I have to leave for another meeting.
No, thank you for
thank
staying
you very
here.
Much for all the information.
Yeah. Thank you, Maria. Lovely.
Thank you.
So I'm just seeing if there is another question. No, I don't think so. So John, I leave you the last word. I just quickly want to say thank you again to everyone who joined us today. Thank you, especially to Anna, who believed in me when we met at your accreditation workshop, John, just the two of us. And, you know, for introducing me to this beautiful piece of work that I really cherish. So thank you for that. And then thank you to Anya and all of the change makers and everyone in the Core Change team for the way we co-create together. It's just a lot of fun. And I hope we got this across today.
Absolutely. Wonderful. Thank you so much. I couldn't agree more. And especially with your last point that, you know, we create that ripple effect in organizations. And again, to your point, just a few sentences ago, you know, the three of us with Ali met in an accreditation, and it seems to have had an effect and led to bigger and greater things. So thank you guys so much for the collaboration. I really don't know that I have much more to add. Appreciate your input so much. I think everybody benefited from it, myself absolutely included. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, everyone. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, guys.